MGM try to launch their own Stargate-based streaming service?
And they did. I actually got to talk to the guys in charge of that at the Orville Experience, StargateCommand.co. It didn't fail. It's active. They released that prequel. It did okay. It wasn't great. It wasn't bad. It wasn't good. It was whatever. And now they're talking about doing another series, and they're talking to the original guy that started it all. I forgot his name right now. Brad Wright, I want to say. Brad Wright. They're talking to Brad Wright about a brand new series, and he was just on a podcast talking about it.
Well, it's funny. I thought it was Martin Wood they were talking to, or was it Brad Wright?
It was Brad Wright.
Yeah. Okay.
The guys who did all the really good Stargate shows, they recently went off to Canada and did Travelers, and that just got canceled by Netflix. So
I was very sad about that.
Yeah, it was a great show. But now they're all, and plus Dark Matter, they also did Dark Matter, and that got canceled as well.
Yeah.
Brad Wright, dude, hell of a sci-fi guy. He's a good sci-fi showrunner.
Oh, yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. So if MGM is smart, they'll snatch him up before he does another project and redo it. But you know, MGM's track record is not great.
They're not smart at all.
No, they don't make good decisions. Aren't they kind of
failing? I mean, they've even had talks of like Joe Flanagan wanting to bring back maybe an Atlantis movie that he was going to, because I think he bought a lot of the rights himself.
He bought a lot of the rights and he tried to crowdfund it, but then they blocked him. So he bought the majority of the rights, but they still blocked him from being able to do it, which makes no sense. Why would you?
That's money in the bank. Just crowdfund the project.
Easy money.
And I would watch it because I'm a huge Atlantis fan. I kind of prefer it to SG-1 sometimes.
Can you imagine if Momoa came back for that?
Oh, God. That would be great.
One thing I'm learning is buying all the rights to something is not buying all the rights. And this is from watching Midnight's Edge and Robert Meter Burnett. You can own all the rights to something and still can't use everything in it.
Because it's incredible.
IP. You know, that...
Anybody
read Hitchhiker and remember the spaceship that was run on bistro mathematics because nobody could ever figure them out? They were quantum. That's the intellectual property is the same thing. It's so quantum it could generate like a star. It makes no freaking sense at all. And I'll be doing a video. I just got some news, some crazy Star Wars news that's very similar to what's going on in Star Trek.
Well, luckily for Stargate,
I can't say anything right now, but I'll tell you. I'll message you. It's been pinging to me right now. So,
luckily for Stargate, the acting CEO of MGM, their online division, like Stargate Command, their acting CEO is this big investor who is a massive fan of the original Stargate TV series, and that happened like a year ago. And then they went and they hired. The guy that made Survivor on CBS, what's his name? Someone
Mark Burnett.
Yeah, they hired Mark Burnett to be the CEO of that division. So the investor that owns more than 50% of MGM right now literally hired Mark Burnett to be the acting CEO of the MGM online television division. And they're both massive fans of Stargate, according to their old social post. So if I had to put money on it, I would say a new Stargate is in the works.
Well, I think it is too. I've been hearing things that it is.
But. Dean Devlin and Roland Emmerich about coming back and rebooting the movie franchise.
Right. And that kind of made Independence Day too. And MGM was like, screw that.
Talk about an IP that was taken though. Stargate was taken away from Dean Devlin and Roland Emmerich. Yeah. They had no control over the.
They had no input or involvement with the TV.
Or money.
Which I think I'm okay with, guys, because their version of the TV show would have been only that Stargate going to that one planet. That's it.
Mm.
Well, but they did create the concept, you know.
They stole the concept, ended up in a lawsuit that where they paid out the original writer of Stargate like $50,000 and told him to be quiet about it. They took the idea from a guy from some high school writing professor that lived in the Midwest somewhere. He wrote a book. You could still buy it. It's called Egyptology. He wrote the book. It's literally the entire concept of Stargate was taken from this guy's book. He sued the studio and they paid him out and he went quiet. That's exactly what happened. Dean Devlin, they stole the idea from this dude.
I don't know if you guys remember this, but Stargate started off as a Showtime original series.
Yes.
So like it's got nudity and adult stuff. And then like once it transitioned away from paid TV to cable, It got a lot more family friendly.
Stargate, dude, Stargate got lucky. The reason Stargate was successful was because they had a built-in two seasons paid for by Showtime. Mm-hmm. I just did this whole Stargate doc, and when I learned about how lucky Stargate was, if they had not had two seasons already paid for in the can, ready to go, it would never have taken off into what it became, because the first season didn't have the ratings. In fact, Showtime ended up dropping it, but by the time they dropped it, it had gotten popular enough for Sci-Fi to pick it up, and it was pure luck that Showtime made the mistake of picking up Stargate. Well, not a mistake, but for them it was a mistake. They thought, oh, we're getting all these views off this pilot episode because they like Stargate, when in reality they just liked the guy that was running Outer Limits at the time, and that's why they watched. And so they picked it up, and it found its audience. 15 years later, it's a cultural phenomenon.
Mm-hmm. And how many episodes of all across all the shows?
Oh,
200 plus, right?
Hundreds, yeah. There's hundreds.
Yeah,
it was 10 seasons plus. Of SG-1, five of Atlantis.
You know, I remember I watched like the 200th episode, and it was like, mm-hmm. it had this like massive budget that Sci-Fi was advertising. Like, look at this huge budget we have for the 200th episode. And then like the next day they canceled it.
It was a shame. It was a shame that Stargate Galaxies was just like such a bad show.
Universe. Well, Stargate. they tried to go too dark, you know. They tried because Battlestar Galactica was
They discovered it. That's what they did. They
but it was not nearly as bad as Discovery. You had cohesive characters. Yeah. It wasn't great, but it wasn't Discovery level. It wasn't Discovery bad.
They tried to make Battlestar Galactica, but with the Stargate version.
And for me, Stargate really worked with like the huge ensemble of like little side characters being funny off on the background, and it worked by being a show that didn't take itself too seriously. You know, you've got O'Neill coming in, Gwaul's like, I'm the biggest, baddest thing. He's like, oh, for crying out loud. You're a guy in a bathrobe or something, Stargate was so fun for me. Like, I loved that.
Yeah, a big problem with SGU was the Rush character was sort of painted to be this like anti-hero guy, but they never gave him that hero moment. They just kept painting him as a dirtbag the whole time.
I love Robert Carlyle, who played Dr. Rush.
Same.
And I was so like, oh yes, we've got Robert Carlyle coming in for this. What are they going to do with him? And they turned him into kind of a less likable Rodney McKay. It's like, okay,
right. Yes.
We already had McKay.
But I remember watching SGU and I was like, this is like a bad version of McKay. It's like an asshole version of McKay. And McKay is already a lovable asshole. So what are you going to do with that?
Eli was never the Daniel Jackson character that we all wanted. You know, he was just kind of like fumbling through things, and they kept referring to him as like their savior, and it was like he didn't do anything. You know,
the problem with that though, the guy was a guy living it literally. It's not hyperbole. Living in his mom's basement, playing video games, and he was playing like a Stargate video game. And they picked him up because he solved the riddle.
Because he solved the riddle, he last Starfired it, and that's how they got
him.
And
now he's like a billion miles away trying to save a crew of people. My thing is, that's a cool concept, but like, you gotta give him more. Like, maybe make him like, maybe he's like an undercover genius, but he's also a slacker. I don't know. You could have done more with that writing. Cool idea, bad execution.
You could have done more with that entire show. It had a great cast. But
great
like
cast.
Are you guys at all excited for Carnival Row?
Oh yeah, I am.
I've been waiting to see this for 20 years because it was a screenplay called A Killing on Carnival Row that was written by Travis Beecham, who wrote Pacific Rim. And it was a spec script, just like Pacific Rim was. And it was one of my favorite unproduced screenplays for the longest time. And Guillermo del Toro was going to direct it at one point. And I can't believe they've turned it into a series. I'm deliriously excited to see this thing.
It does have a horror look to it. It looks pretty good.
It's like a horror thing, right?
It's like a Victorian era steampunkish fantasy thing.
Ooh, I like steampunk.
Orlando Bloom and Cara Devaline, I think.
Yeah, Mrs. Nerdrotic's really excited for this.
Dude, any TV show or movie that has the steampunk style that's done correctly is like an A-plus for me. I love that. I was about to say,
you had me at steampunk.
You had me at steampunk, babe.
Yeah, it does have horror elements to it. I mean, it's. I can't wait. I hope it's... You know, we were talking about a little earlier, but the fact that we have The Expanse, which is a literary-based show, you've also got The Man in the High Castle was based on a classic science fiction novel. A Handmaid's Tale is a science fiction novel. We are getting maybe not as much space-based stuff, and now they're going to do a Bene Gesserit TV series, which is Dune, it's pretty amazing that they're delving into the classics of sci-fi literature to then, because I mean, Man in the High Castle is certainly not a new book either. And to look back at the writers of the, I want to see a Heinlein Stranger in a Strange Land series. I mean, who knows what we're going to get next? I can't, or I'd love to see a Dan Simmons Hyperion series if they ever do that. Scorsese was trying to do that as a film for a long time. And it's pretty great what we're seeing because of these streaming.
One of the good streaming wars is that you need so much content to feed these new platforms that they're just going to be pulling in anything that has a built-in fan base and trying to turn it into a movie or TV
show. There's a small window for it, but yes, I mean, we've actually been getting it. This is kind of a renaissance for TV and
because
of the paradigm shift in Hollywood. We're getting, they're taking more chances. I wish they would take them with our franchises, but you know, we get the Expanse out of it, and you know, I hated how Game of Thrones ended, but it really set, you know, I'm cautious. I want the Lord of the Rings show to be good, but I mean, 20 episodes for the first season, they're spending $1 billion on the show, but the guys running it are just, it's very discouraging. It is, but
well, you can say that Watchmen.
It's very interesting, like the choices that they've made to shepherd these TV shows. Like the people who are doing The Witcher, they don't have a lot under their belt. The guy's doing the Wheel of Time series, like he was an actor who had no producing experience at all, and they just handed him this show. So it's gonna be interesting to see how these come out. But the good thing about Game of Thrones is that it inspired all these networks to realize that there's a big audience out there for epic fantasy.
Oh yeah.
You know.
Absolutely. No, we thank it for
my
that.
My question is, why has no one picked up like the Foundation series yet?
They have.
Yeah, they've tried. They've been trying to make that. It's like, does Showtime or HBO have that now?
I actually think the guy who was the original showrunner on The Man in the High Castle is the one who's kind of trying to get that going.
You know, have you guys watched,
who's
there's another show run. Oh.
I'm sorry to cut you off. I'm sorry. Where is that coming from, Matt?
I just said the guy who was with Amazon, who started The Man in the High Castle.
Oh, I see.
He was the one who, I think, last I read, he was the one who was trying to get that off the ground as either a series on one of the streaming networks.
Because that is like prime for a TV show.
I have to say, though, I don't just want Foundation. I want the robot series and Foundation.
Yes!
They're kind of the same continuity.
Yeah, what about an Elijah Bailey procedural? You know,
you've got the Caves of Steel series. Thank you. Yes. Now we're speaking the same language here.
Why isn't Isaac Asimov getting more love here? I mean, like, he's like the godfather of sci-fi.
They have no idea who he is, mostly, probably.
Before you go, check out these other videos that may interest you in our sister channel, Midnight's Edge After Dark, for more live shows and more laid-back content.